Got a panel here I'm going to pull up here, and we are going to have, I think, one of the most timely, interesting discussions that could be had in Houston, Texas, in the middle of this balmy autumn afternoon of great heat. I want to first introduce for you, let's start with Jim Hoffmeier, the man who needs no introduction because he spends more time here than I do, but just in case you don't know Jim, I'll tell you not only the things that you need to know about him. He's PhD, teaches at Trinity Evangelical Divinity School outside Chicago, teaches Old Testament. He's an Egyptologist, has archaeologically dug over in Egypt for decades. But he grew up in Egypt as well. His parents were Egyptian missionaries, which makes it really interesting to watch him walk through airport and talk Arabic with his friends and upset everybody that works at TSA. And look at him like, what are you speaking Arabic? What do you know that we don't know? But we've got Jim on the panel today, and we're delighted to have him. Next, I want to bring up Father Mario Arroyo, born in Havana, Cuba in 1949. His parents immigrated to the U.S. under the Castro regime, I believe.
Yes.
And Father Arroyo grew up then mostly in the U.S., obviously at least bilingual, if not more. He did attend St. Mary's in Houston, and he is the parish pastor of St. Cyril of Alexandria Church, which in Protestant terminology is a Catholic megachurch. That's what we would call it, I guess. I mean, you have how many families? 4,000 or 5,000 families at that church. That's not people, that's families. So 10,000 plus people. And how many masses on a weekend?
Six.
How many in English?
Four
in English, two in Spanish. And you might hear Father Mario, I guess is the way to say it. You might hear Father Mario on the radio. He and David Capes have a radio program for, David's been on for, I think, the last 12 years, but Father Mario has been on for at least 7 of the last 12. And it sounds like a joke, but it's a rabbi, a father, and a Catholic, a Protestant, and a Jew walk into a radio station. And Father Mario has done a lot of research and keeps up with current events and speaks on the influence of culture on faith, and obviously has a heart and an eye toward the immigrant and people outside the United States and the way things are perceived. And then our guest of honor for the weekend, who we're really delighted, we've worked for over a year to get Mark here, is Mark Movsesian, who is a law professor at St. John's University School of Law, one of the nation's preeminent law schools in my mind. He is not only one of their great professors, but he heads up their Institute on Religion and Faith. And he is here this evening and this weekend, along with Dean Mike Simons, who I might ask a few questions of. Mike, another good friend of ours, and his wonderful wife, Karen. Mike is the dean of that law school. If you've got any kids you need to get into law school, you want him to be your best friend. That's how I met him, and and it's worked out well for us so far. Mark Movsesian, though, was voted Professor of the Year. He's got two of his law students with us who are, there they are, Stephanie and John. And Stephanie and John work on the panel or the program for the Institute of Faith and Studies. We all had lunch together, but I made John and Stephanie ride back with me in the car privately. And I said, okay, I eat with all of, we've got a daughter and a son-in-law in law school there. I said, I eat with them and their friends all the time. I'm always asking them questions. And I want to know from you, who's your favorite professor you've had at law school? Because I'm trying to figure out who they are. And I don't have the dean in the car. I don't have anybody else in the car. It's just the two students. And I said I wouldn't tell. And I lied because I never knew that they would say it, but Mark Movsesian is the guy. and was quickly said, you know, you'd think we were just saying this, but he's not in the car. He really is the best law professor we've had, which makes sense to me why he was voted professor of the year or whatever recently at the law school. He's very well published. He's a law school at Harvard?
Yes.
Harvard Law School graduate, which is the, if y'all don't know, that's the Texas Tech of the Northeast. And it's just a delight to have him here. We've got a microphone. I've got my questions on my iPhone, so if you'll don't think I'm doing messages while I talk to them. But what I want to do is I want to work through the dialogue, and I want to do it in a pretty open forum, because I think you're going to have some questions here that you may not want to wait till tonight to ask after his lecture this evening, because he'll have a little different emphasis tonight than what we've got here, I reckon. I think you need to be loud, be bold, be proud. If you've got a question, we'll try and engage it in the panel as we go along so that this is an interactive dialogue. You will rarely get this kind of a blend with this kind of knowledge. And so I had the joy of eating lunch with him, and I got to ask my questions over lunch, some of which I'm going to re-ask here because I find them fascinating, and I find their answers fascinating. So let's start, never dreaming this would be on the front pages of our papers. I want to start with Professor Movsesian. We'll start with you, Mark. So we read in the paper, and we see on the news this vivid beheading of journalists by this Islamic terrorist group called ISIS. And then we get these emails across our internet that say anybody who is a Muslim or an Islamic follower of the Quran must be some type of a jihadist, because that's what we have. You've spent a good portion of your life studying this area of the law, specifically from foreign perspectives. Tell us, is that typical? Is that truth to their religion to behead journalists and to do this type of stuff?
So is this on?
It should be.
Well, first let me say thank you very much to Mark.
Is it on? Can y'all hear it?
Yes? Good. So first let me say thank you to Mark and to the Lanier Theological Library for having me here this weekend. I'm very much looking forward to my time with you this afternoon and also this evening. So thanks so much. And I also want to thank my students for saying that, because it shows I've trained them well. And they know how to answer these questions when they're asked. Now, to your question. So I think that I'm going to talk about this more tonight, but briefly, I think that there are two mistakes that are often made in the West when people in the West think about Islam. The first mistake is to say that a group like ISIS, the jihadis, represent real, quote-unquote, or authentic, quote-unquote, Islam, as though there's nothing else. And that is not true, and that is not fair to the vast majority of Muslims in the world who do not condone this sort of activity, even very conservative Muslims, you know? And in particular, don't condone what's happening to the Christians in Iraq and northern Syria, or the Christians in Nigeria, where Boko Haram, another jihadi group, is also conducting atrocities. So that's unfair to say this is the real Islam and everyone is like this. That's just not only unfair, it's untrue. It's not a true statement. On the other hand, there's also an impulse that says, well, this has nothing to do with the real Islam, that if you really understood Islam, you'd know that, you know, segregating Christians is totally abhorrent and so on. And sadly, that also is not true. What ISIS is doing, if we leave aside the beheadings, if we just focus on what they've done to Christians and Yazidis, the terms that they have offered Christians and Yazidis, which is basically, well, for Christians, accept Islam or accept the terms of the dhimma, which is a notional agreement that Christians make that gives them a subservient status, or leave. This is not something that ISIS just made up. This is part of the historical tradition of Islam as well. So I think the answer to your question would be to say, no, not every Muslim is a jihadi, and it would be wrong to say that. On the other hand, it would also be untruthful to say that what ISIS is doing is totally unprecedented in Islam, and we've never heard of this before, and so on. And I understand why people say that, because you know, you don't want to be unfair to other people, and especially Muslims living in America who are perfectly peace-loving people and should not be tarred with this. But unless you honestly assess what the situation is, you're also never going to solve the problem. So that's how I'd answer your question.
All right, I'm going to skip you, Father Mario, because your question comes after Jim's. Dr. Hoffmeier, question for you. You grew up in Egypt. Egypt is an Islamic country. You have gone back to Egypt many, many times. You've spent a lifetime in and out of Egypt and other Middle Eastern countries. Have you experienced anything relevant to this discussion in your life experiences? And then I'm going to jump from that, and Father Mario, we're going to tie in Cuba and other regimes with this, so tune in to this as well.
Well, let me first tell you my talking Arabic at an airport story, which happened on my way here. And that was, we were driving in a van from our remote parking lot, and all of a sudden the driver took a wrong exit. We were heading towards Chicago instead of the airport. He calls on his phone back to the office and is speaking Arabic. And so I started guiding him back the way he should go in Arabic. And he was his third day on the job. He was an Iraqi Arab. So Arabic does come in helpful at airports sometimes. Yes, and I could probably talk all afternoon about different stories, anecdotes, experiences I have had. And I will certainly support what Mark has said, that is the first Mark who spoke, I mean, not the lawyer Mark. Which one's that? Anyway, the lawyer of this panel. Growing up in Egypt, of course, I lived largely in a smaller Christian village. But there was clearly, even where they were a majority, in this village, had to put up with certain things because they weren't Muslims. But I'd like to fast forward to more recent days, because things have changed a lot. There are a couple different markers in Egypt where things changed. First of all, when Egypt was invaded in 641 AD, the kind of things that we're seeing today in Iraq is what took place in North Africa and elsewhere. So in many ways, this is a return to the roots that we're seeing. Now, the good news is that there has been moderation over the centuries, in recent centuries, but every now and then things happen which sort of get the ball going again, and we may talk about some of those other things. But I've had the fortunes of working as an archaeologist. I hire every one of my workers, and I was working in what today we call Sinai, Northern Sinai, and I hire about 30 some workers, all of whom are Muslims. And the government officials that we work for, all my years working in that area, about 10 years, only one of the government officials I worked with was Christian. My favorite young inspector who I work with recently got his PhD. We're good friends. I send him greetings on the Muslim holidays. He sends me email greetings on Christmas and so on. But this one little story perhaps can illustrate some of the tensions that we perhaps in the West have with fully appreciating and understanding the culture and the religion. When my friend got married, I asked him, "Oh, show me a picture of your wife." He says, "I have no pictures of my wife."
Hold the mic up.
"You have no wedding pictures?" "No, no wedding pictures." And then some years later, my wife and I were invited to his home along with several colleagues to have refreshments and dessert and a cake that she had made for us. But we couldn't go and see her. And halfway through the evening, my friend Hisham says to my wife, "Kathy, would you like to meet my wife?" And she did, and went back and met this very delightful woman who would not at all appear to come and say hello to us. A very awkward thing happened a couple weeks later. We were at a nearby town, Ismailia, where the Muslim Brotherhood was founded in the 1920s. And we went into the Pizza Hut. And there sat my friend Hisham with his wife, all in black, decked from head to toe, but a slit in her eyes, for her eyes. And I walked up to the table. I had to say hello to him. What do you say to her? I said, it's nice to see you. But he's such a delightful man. I consider him a very, very close friend, very devout Muslim. And yet, we're driving along, and I'm listening to the Hallelujah chorus and Handel's Messiah. It was the Easter time. And the next time we got in the car, he says, could we hear that again? So I can say that I've had wonderful relationships with Muslims. But I think things in the last couple years have changed to the point that just because you're an American or just because you're a Westerner, it's a very different attitude towards us just in the last couple years.
All right, with that, let's hand it to Father Mario. And I want to ask you, Father, your parents left Cuba with at least you. I don't know if you have siblings.
Yes, I do. I have a brother, younger brother, and a younger sister.
And did your parents ever tell you why they left?
Yes.
And what does their persecution story echo some of what's going on with Christians in other places?
Not at all. My father, my uncle, I left Cuba when I was 10 years old.
10?
10.
Okay.
And I'm 65, so that tells you I've been here in the United States 55 years. My uncle was the ambassador to the United States under Batista, who was the former dictator slash president of Cuba. And since my uncle was already in Washington, D.C., in the embassy when Castro took over, they did not immediately start looking for my father, because what they wanted to do was to basically hold my father hostage and my family hostage to get at my uncle. there was enough friends that my father had in the military, actually my mother's, my uncle on my mother's side, that they heard that that there was a kind of an interest in holding us in some way to get at my uncle. And so what happened was that before it got too high in the government, this decision, my mom told my brother and sister that we were all going on vacation to Miami. We were not yet banned from leaving. And so we went and got on the boat. My father would not attempt to leave because he knew he couldn't. And then from there, he immediately went into the Mexican embassy where he was, took asylum. And then they took him from the Mexican embassy about 3 months later. And he went into Mexico and he was able to reunite himself with us in the United States.
Wow.
So my coming here, and I didn't come in any kind of a rowboat. It was a very nice ferry. So I have no dramatic, you know, story about
that. That's pretty dramatic, though. I mean, that's still pretty good.
Yeah. So ours had nothing to do with persecution in terms of Christianity. At that time, the persecution of Christianity had not become part of the regime. But I think the communist persecution of Christianity and Islamic persecution are radically different. They don't have the same source, I am not as concerned when I study communism. I am not as concerned about communism as I am about Islamism.
Why?
Because I think Western culture tends to underestimate the power of religion in the behavior of people. We live in a secularized environment where religion, during the Enlightenment especially, was sort of relegated to the outer fringes of personal issue between you and God. And that is a totally Western understanding. And when you enter into Islam, and other experiences of Christianity. That is not the case at all. That whole notion of individualism and individualism infecting the understanding of religion, especially in Islam, where there is no such thing as separation of church and state, which is a totally Western, particularly American, understanding through the English experience. So Islam is a much more powerful engine of religious persecution of other religions, and it has been so for 1400 years. And the only thing we're doing right now is experiencing a resurgence of what has been intermittently resurging, recurring throughout 1400 years. As a matter of fact, the other day, and I have not researched this statement that I'm about to make, so I could be open to, you know, some criticism on it, but I turned to my friend and I said, the Crusades are starting to look a little different, aren't they? Because if you start looking at who was the superpower during the era of the Crusades, there was no United States. And what we are doing right now is getting ready to basically go on a crusade, although you would never call it that, but we are going to demolish Islamic oppression of Christians, which was the original source. Now, did all the crusaders behave according to that? Of course not. In every war, there's opportunism. But the Crusades, the only superpower at that time, at the time of the Crusades, was the Vatican, and the only one that could unite the powers of Europe. And so to my way of thinking, I'm starting to see some patterns that make the Crusades look a little bit different.
All right, if we could go back to Professor Movsesian. Mark, last Sunday morning at our church, it was a day where we were praying for the nations of sorts. And a video was played that talked about the countries with the top five persecution of Christians. And if I recall the video correctly, several were communist, North Korea and China, and the other three were Islamic or Muslim-based. I believe Iraq, either Somalia or who was it?
Syria.
No, it may have been Syria as well right now. I don't recall. But I'd like to, you are a specialist in this as well. Mark, for those of you who may not know, presided over a St. John's and another law school in Rome put together a symposium this summer on religious persecution in Rome. And it so impressed the Pope that the Pope, in essence, invited Mark, Dean Simons, and their friends, which meant me and Becky at least, among others, to a meeting in the Vatican over this issue, because the Pope was so impressed with what was going on and what Mark was putting on. And so, Mark, my question to you, would you tell us a little bit about how you see the difference in persecution between the Islamic areas and the communist areas, and just sort of give us your insight on this point?
Sure. So, the first thing I'd say in response is that I'm glad your church was praying for this, because, in fact, this is not a story that gets out very much. And, you know, I think it's fair to say Christians at the moment are the most persecuted religious group in the world. Now, when I make comments like that in Western or American audiences, people chuckle or they scoff or they, you know, because in America, although maybe there are some tensions rising in America about Christianity, it's not persecution at all. And so I remember I was at an academic conference once and I made this comment that, you know, Christians are the most persecuted group in the world, and a German theologian actually said, next you're going to tell me that the billion Chinese are the most persecuted people in the world, right? His point was that, you know, there are so many Christians, how can you possibly say they're being persecuted? But the fact is they are, and there are books that have come out on this in the last couple of years about this, that around the world they are the targets, the main targets, or the, I'd say they are, if you want to be conservative, they are a principal target of persecution in the world. I think probably they're the most. So I'm glad you're talking about it. Now, why are Christians being persecuted in these various places? Well, the communist world I'm not an expert in, but, and I maybe Father Arroyo can talk more about that, but that was essentially the end of the Enlightenment in a way, it was, you know, the communists came out of the Enlightenment. It was religion is the opiate of the masses. You know, religion has held back progress. And of course, the religion they were thinking of principally was Christianity. That was the historic enemy. And I think you still see something like that sometimes in the way secular people talk. This was the enemy. And so it's ideological, you know? And it seems to be petering out in most places in the world, but not in China. I would think that's an ideological dispute that's being had. Islam is slightly different, and as Father Mario is saying, Islam, Christians can be tolerated as long as they have a subordinate status. So I'll talk about this a little more tonight. So in classical Islam, the rule is that you cannot attempt to convert anyone to Christianity, nor can you attempt to prevent a Christian from converting to Islam. That's the rule. If you do something like that, you have broken the deal, and you're subject to punishment. And so in Islam, it is much more of a religiously based thing. It is something that is seen as, when we do this, we are doing the will of Allah. We're doing the will of God. This is what God wants us to do. And I agree with Father Mario that that's a much more powerful motivator. So I read something about this once, so I forget exactly who said it. I know who it was, actually. It was Samuel Tadros. Samuel Tadros is an author, works at the Hudson Institute. And he's recently written a book called, I think it's called Persecuted, but it's about the Copts in Egypt. And he said, under the dictatorship, the secular nationalistic, they were not communist, but under Mubarak and Sadat and Nasser, these were nationalist dictatorships. You could always negotiate with somebody. You could always buy off the dictator or buy off the dictator's henchmen or something. You could work out an arrangement. But with the Islamists, you really can't work out an arrangement. They're not in a mood to deal with you, really. And so that's why they're much more dangerous. Would you agree with that statement?
Yeah, Jim, take the mic.
I was just going to say that Sadat very skillfully, as many dictators do, play one minority group off against another. And so the Christians in Egypt during the 70s became a convenient tool to be used against the Muslim Brotherhood. When the Muslim Brotherhood were persecuted a little, they would say, well, how come you're not doing it in the kitchen to the Christians? So then they'd run over, okay, let's arrest some Christians. And the Orthodox Pope was put under monastery arrest, and he couldn't leave. And so sometimes strong men will do that. And so most Christians in Syria were very happy with Assad because he looked out for them and could use them when convenient. So sometimes, I think back a couple years ago talking to a Coptic friend of mine, a Coptic Christian, and asking him, when the next election comes, are you going to vote for this other candidate who's running against Mubarak? And he said, oh, no. I said, oh, he's much more interested in democratic principles and so on and so forth. And my friend Amgad said to me, he said, better the devil you know than the devil you don't know. So they would vote in Mubarak again and again. He will protect them at times. And they can make a deal. And the Coptic church, because you had a very powerful, they like to use the word pope, sorry, Rome. they like to have their own pope, and that pope would negotiate things and arrangements that made things tolerable for Christians or better than at other times. And every now and then when there was problems, Mubarak would say, Christians fought with us in 1973. Christians fought with us in 1967. Christians fought with us in 1948. And so the nation, yes, they fought with us. So, yeah.
Yeah, I've heard it said, and Father Mario, you'll be grabbing the mic next, so you keep up with current events more than most, if for no other reason than you have such a huge congregation and you've got this radio show, weekly radio show. But I've heard it said that the U.S. government supported dictators over democracy in so many Middle Eastern countries, whether it's the king of Jordan, the Hashemite kingdom of Jordan, whether it's the king of Saudi Arabia, whether it was Mubarak in Egypt, the support for dictators was in part over a fear that if democracy took place, the common people would elect the Muslim extremists that would be antagonistic towards America and what we stand for. So the better form of government in the Muslim countries is one of a tolerant dictatorship. Your thoughts?
Well, actually, the answer is, would that there would have been that enlightened a motivation. I think that, I don't think that, at least my knowledge of American social international policy took that much of, gave that much importance to religion. So that I think you are correct. In effect, that is what happened. But I don't know that it was a conscious act on the part of American foreign policy. But that is, in fact, what's happening. And, you know, it's very hard for Americans and Westerners to understand, because I asked several people the other day, you know, when you were growing up, and I bet most of us, if I asked you, when you were growing up, what was the chief fear? And the chief fear was communism. You never heard of a fear about Islam. And what's happened is that we have taken our eyes off of the macro view of history. And what is happening right now in the Islamic world is I would call it a normal flow, ebb and flow of intensification of devotion to Islamic, to the faith. Precise over the years, if you notice, from the inception of Islam, through its history of its expansion, through the Middle Ages and the Ottoman Empire, and then post-World War I and World War II, if you look at the macro view, this is just the wave of jihadism has tamped down, has come down, and then it's come up, and it's come down, and it's come up. We're just experiencing the latest wave in which, you're right, the nationalistic leaders were toppled, and we all in the United States were just giddy over the Arab Spring. And there was no such thing as an Arab Spring. When you chopped off the heads of the dictators, which we were so outraged at our government because we were supporting dictators, and of course we expected that as soon as the dictators were done away with, that democracy would flourish. And there was a small amount of democratic sentiments. But democracy is basically incompatible with Islam. As a matter of fact, the very notion of democracy is heresy, because what you're saying is that power to the demos, power to the people. And in Islam, there is no such thing as power to the people. That is an assimilation and a grabbing of power from Allah. People have no right to make laws. It is only Allah that makes law. And when people are given the right to make a law, that is a usurpation of the power of Allah. And so it was at its fundamental, this intensification. Bernard Lewis is very good in this, in terms of his book, What Went Wrong. Bernard Lewis looks at it, all of a sudden Islam looks at itself in the modern world and says, I thought we were supposed to take over the world. I thought we were supposed to be the domination. And all of a sudden they find themselves in a backwater, you know, part of civilization, with Western civilization mushrooming. And they ask themselves, what went wrong? And the answer they come up with is, we have not been faithful to jihad. We have not been faithful to the original commandment of Allah. And which, when we rededicate ourselves now, and what you're seeing is the rededication of the driving engine of the Islamic world, you're seeing the rededication to their original purpose when they look back at Muhammad. And when they look back at Muhammad, what they see is the warrior. And what you're experiencing is the flow of history moving into, and that's where the idealism of Islam, granted, not every Muslim is like that, because, you know, the whole issue with are there such thing as moderate Muslims. People would argue that there is not. There's a saying which I risk, I'll say it, but it's, please understand it, you have to understand it correctly, that the only good Muslim is a bad Muslim. And that means that it's a Muslim that doesn't take it literally, that isn't going back to what is radical, rooting. The moment you go into root, to get deeper into faith, the moment you look into Muhammad as the ideal of Muslim maleness, you already end up as a radical jihadist. And so there are Muslims who have adapted to our culture very well, and we need to respect them because we cannot betray our own culture. We need to respect. And by the way, and I'll close with this, I highly recommend Robert Riley. I don't know if any of you have read Robert Riley's book, The Closing of the Muslim Mind. It is the most important book on the development of Islamic theology that I have ever read. What he documents is the encounter with early Muslims in Spain and other places with the Greek tradition of reason. And the question was, can you use reason to understand the Quran? And there was a group, especially in Spain, and that's where you hear this beautiful story of Islamic inventions and Islamic culture and stuff like that. And they were called the Mutazilites. And the Mutazilites began to say, you can use reason to understand the Quran. And the Quran is a created reality that you can update by applying reason to it and getting to know Allah through that way. They were defeated by a group called the Azurites. And the Azurites in the 9th, 10th, and 11th century were people who said, no, you may not use reason. Because if you use reason in understanding the Quran, you are basically saying that reason is greater than Allah. And Allah is all-powerful, and Allah is not even bound by reason. The Azurites defeated the Mutazilites, and therefore the school, the predominant school of Muslim theology that you find today is the successor of Azurite theology, which says that Allah is so powerful that he can contradict himself. He can tell you, it is a good thing for you to get on an airplane and run it into a building full of people. And you do it, not because you think it's evil, but because you think it's good. Because goodness is done by the will of Allah, not by goodness residing in and of itself.
All right. Professor Movsesian.
I just follow up one thing here? So just to make one slight change at the end of what you said. It's what Father Mario is talking about is abstract reasoning, right? What we in the Christian world might think of as natural law reasoning. Yes. That has been eliminated. So it's not that to be Muslim means you don't think about anything. No. Because actually there is plenty of exegetical thinking in Islam. You know, the Quran says something, well, what does it mean? What do these words mean? How do we apply it? So in that sense, there is reasoning. It's just not the kind of abstract reasoning about good or evil.
There's no natural law.
There's no natural law.
All right, concept, so... Right? I want to follow up in another direction, and to do it, I want to understand something, Professor, about your background before I do. How long have you been intrigued and studied this? Is this a recent thing for you, or have you been doing it for years? How long has this been an area?
So I first started studying this systematically, I would say, what year is this, 2014? So maybe 7-8 years ago, actually, when I first came to St. John's, in fact.
Okay. So in the process of that, have you already seen some changes and some cycling in the way this is happening and unfolding, or has it been pretty much of a consistent, no ebb and flow at this point?
No, it's certainly been ebb and flow. And what Father Mario says is, I'm not sure I joined everything that he said, exactly how he said it, but the point that throughout Islamic history, there have been periods of relative calm, and then there have been eruptions of this kind of jihadist activity, which have come about
when the Muslim world has felt threatened in some way from the outside, or when there are bad times or something. But it's in the warp and woof of Islam. It's not something that's just, so it's not just a political crisis. It's a political crisis that then leads to a certain kind of Islamic activity. So that's right. Now, to answer your question in a kind of roundabout way, and also to follow up on Father Mario, there are Islamic revisionists today. There are people who are writing, for example, in Rome, at the conference that we hosted in Rome, we had a professor from Emory Law School called Abdu An-Naim. And Abdu is sort of the Muslim John Locke. He is trying to come up with a Muslim theory of the separation of mosque and state. And his point is that Islam really should be a matter of private, voluntary activity. It should not be state supported. He's trying to separate them.
How's it working?
So if you talk to Abdu, he's a very charming guy. Abdu is from Sudan. He no longer lives in Sudan. He lives in the United States and writes in the United States. And that is because he was afraid to stay in Sudan. And when I first met him, he's a very charming guy. When I first met him, he joked about waiting for the fatwa. He keeps waiting for the fatwa, but he said, the thing is, they don't translate my work, so they don't read them. But if they read them, you know, they'd give me the fatwa. He will be the first to tell you that his is a very minority view in Islam. There's a guy called Tariq Ramadan. You may have heard of Tariq Ramadan. He had trouble getting into the US a few years ago. He's a little controversial. But he has written a book called Radical Reform, in which he says Islam is a matter of faith. It is not a matter of law. It is not a matter of government. But I think he'd be the first to say this is a threatening idea to the majority of Muslims in the world. So the short answer to your question is yes, I have seen ebbs and flows. I see there are changes now. But I have to say, in my experience, the Muslims who are revisionists or are trying to rethink the religion for a pluralist world tend to be Western academics. They don't tend to be people living in Muslim-majority societies. They get out if they're in Muslim-majority societies, and they come to the U.S. and they write here. Now, I'll close with one anecdote from, again, I keep quoting my friend Abdu. I wish he'd be a great person to listen to. And he said to me, when I raised this point with him, I said, well, you know, Abdu, this is a heretical thing you're saying. And he said, well, every orthodoxy begins as a heresy. And so, you know, I'm hoping that I'm going to start out like this and I'll get people behind me and whatever. So, you know, we'll
see. Which is an academic's way of saying every good Muslim is a bad Muslim, I guess, in a sense.
Well, and you know, what you said is correct. It's a very small minority. And you have to, when you read, and I can't, yes, in the West. And I cannot recommend this highly enough. The Robert Riley, The Closing of the Muslim Mind, it is a fascinating read as to a group of Muslims in northern Spain and northern Africa, I mean southern Spain and northern Africa, who tried to do this at the beginning of the 11th century, and they were defeated. They were called the Mutazilites, and they were defeated and overwhelmed, and not only the heresy was tamped down.
All right.
Totally.
Mark's got something to add to that, it looked like. Raise your hand, I'm going to go to...
Is that okay?
Yeah, absolutely.
You mentioned Spain, so this reminded me of something. So what Father Arroyo was talking about is the idea of convivencia, that's what they called it, with Muslims and Christians and Jews all living together under Al-Andalus. So when Al-Andalus is what the Muslim world called Spain, Andalusia, right? So when Ferdinand and Isabella reconquered Spain in 1492, the question for the Muslims living there was, well, what shall we do? Shall we remain here or shall we leave? And they asked the Muslim legal scholars, and the answer came back, you have to go. Why? Because it is not correct in Islam to live permanently as a Muslim in a non-Muslim society. You can visit, you can travel, but according to Islam, you have to go. Why? Because in a non-Islamic society, you can't really practice Islam the way it should be practiced. So if you fast forward 500, 600 years, and maybe in the 19th century, there was an Egyptian Muslim scholar called Rashid Rida. And Rida addressed the same kind of question for Muslims living in the Western world, what can they do? And he said, no, you can. He said, it is true that to be a Muslim, you have to be able to practice your faith. But really, all that means is following the rules about worship and prayer and fasting. You don't have to do all the other things. But I think that's an open question. I think it's an open question. So that's another person who's trying to rethink Islam for a pluralist world. but it was not the answer given in 1492, and it may not be the classical answer.
Fantastic. Zip it down to Mr. Old Testament. All right, Professor Hoffmeier, who has Jim put on a seminar here in January dealing with the Exodus, which is available online, will soon be out in book. And among the scholars from around the world, he brought in several Orthodox Jewish scholars who are wonderful, magnificent people. So I'm not impugning them with this. They're fantastic, became good friends in just a brief time, and friends of what we're about here. But there are people within the Jewish world who would say to be a good Jew, reading the Old Testament, God says, this is our land, go kill everyone, man, woman, and child, who live in the promised land and take it over. And so a good Jew would be a bad Jew if you followed that same perspective, because the Jewish people can look at their Jewish scriptures in such a way as to be non-pluralistic, at least when it comes to the land of Palestine. Okay, and so if you're going to say that all Muslims who read the Quran must be that way, then why can't you recognize that within the Jewish world those are a minority of people and yet they're Jews? You follow the argument I'm making here. Yeah. I put that in front of you for you to discuss, please.
Sure. Well, first I would say I think there's a difference between a particular point in history and time where God gives a command and what was meant to be normative for all time and all places. One of the causes of confusion I think we Westerners have and why we get perhaps mixed messages, and it relates to what you're saying, and so follow me, with regards to Islam, is that we forget that the Quran was recorded over a period of time, just as the Bible is recorded over a period of time. Protestants like to speak of progressive revelation, that things become increasingly clearer, more specific in time, and so that perhaps a commandment at one point is not normative for all time, but for a particular social community at a certain time, in a certain place. With Islam, you have a similar situation in that when in Muhammad's early years of his ministry, shall we say, was on rather good terms with Christians and Jews. And some people believe that those surahs of the Quran where he speaks of respecting the people of the book, the people of the book seem to be Jews who have a book and Christians who have a book, the Injil and the Torah. And later on, what happened was Muhammad was extremely disappointed when the Jews did not join his movement. And he turned against the Jews. And the infidel became defined differently later on than at the beginning. And hence you have what appears to be mutually contradictory things. Kill every infidel versus work cooperatively with people of the book. And so some Muslims will latch on to some will latch on to the verses they like, as often Christians may attach themselves to a certain doctrine and neglect others. But I think that may be helpful in putting this in perspective. I don't think there are any Jews today who would say the command of Deuteronomy 7 is applicable for all time, that they would go in and destroy mosques and so on, because that's what God told Moses in Deuteronomy 7 and so on. So I would again go back to what I said, differentiate between what I would say would be a punctiliar command versus what is normative. And I think what Islam is now dealing with is returning to one of those points in time. I would add that I think one of the reasons the most recent wave that we're on, I think, goes back to the Iranian Revolution in 1979, and that seems to have been an important turning point where Muslims in Egypt, like the Muslim Brotherhood, Jamaat al-Islami, saw themselves as following that kind of pattern began in 1979. That's where you get this stronger wave moving that's been going ever since. But I think that, for me, I think that is perhaps the catalyst of the new movement. You can go back a little bit earlier, and I think some of it is the Muslim Brotherhood was largely started as an anti-colonial movement to get rid of British rule in Egypt. And that was their first move. And when that finally succeeded, then it was like, well, now what do we do? And then it moves in a more ideological direction rather than a nationalistic direction.
Okay, so I was in London 2 weeks ago, and I was visiting with a fella from Syria. He had come over to London to go to graduate school, and he had been in London for about a year and a half, 2 years. And I was talking to him about his home country, and his parents had owned a florist shop. He said they had moved from Syria with the recent civil unrest there. Nobody had money to buy flowers, and they weren't in the mood to buy flowers if they had the money. And so his parents had moved to, I think, Lebanon, and were having trouble there as well. And he said, it's so different in England if you're outside of the Muslim community. He said, inside the Muslim community, though, it's still very difficult even in England. Now, Jim, you had mentioned to me about Sharia law within England. I want you to tell us your understanding of that. And then Father Mario, if you've got any insight into that. And then once you two are through, we're going to turn this a little bit more legal, and I'm going to get Dean Simons up here to join us, because we're going to talk about it. What do we from America need to be concerned with in this regard for our country? So, Jim?
Well, I'll only raise the issue, because we were talking a little bit about lunch, and Professor Mark had some very good insights into that. But I think... maybe just in the last week, with some of the comments made by David Cameron, and even earlier on by David Cameron and Angela Merkel and Sarkozy in France, going back a couple years.
David Cameron being the Prime Minister of England, and Merkel being the Chancellor, or whatever they call her, Prime Minister of
Merkel,
Germany.
Yeah.
Yeah, Merkel. Yeah. I've heard it both ways. Yeah.
In each of those countries, I think in the name of multiculturalism, there was... a move that really allowed various communities to function almost autonomously within their respective states. And that seemed to be okay in some areas, but when it got to the area of how punishment might be meted out in other issues, this was causing some problems. And I think this is now perhaps beginning to percolate in Britain, in the light of Cameron's statements in the last couple days, that we've perhaps gone too far. Now we have to correct and pull back in these areas. But that was a problem. I said it was a question I simply ask. There are the beginnings of Sharia in certain Islamic communities in Britain, where they are the vast majority. And then my question was, is that something that potentially could happen here or not?
And by Sharia, define
by Sharia. Sharia is Islamic law, which, as has been pointed out, these are the laws that come from God, not from man, and therefore we can't dispute them. My concern really was in asking the question are there... Well, I know there are some really points of incompatibility between them. Can you have a culture within a culture, an autonomous community functioning with their own laws? And we did talk a little bit about how that might work out. So let me.
All right. Well, we'll go legal in a minute. Okay. But first, Father Mario, do you have any insights in this? The idea of at least in England, there are pockets where they are actually practicing Sharia law, and living under Muslim law, even though they are in a British Commonwealth.
I cannot contribute too much to this, but my only comment would be the Western embarrassment at its own culture. I think we are You know, if you look at many cultures in the world, they are not embarrassed to be who they are. And I think to some degree, multiculturalism, not in all of its ways, but in many of its ways, has tried to make believe that there is such a thing as a neutral culture. And there is no such thing as a neutral culture. And it's almost like we are embarrassed to be Western, and to have, I think it's important that we have a resurgence of the Christian basics. Because if you think about it, the United States and Western culture is a product of Christianity. The very notion of that we are, we hold, you know, in the Declaration when it says, this is just a very quick thing. I always ask people, what are the two founding documents? And I'm almost afraid to talk about this being next to a legal scholar, but I say, what are the founding documents of the United States? And of course, the two main ones are the Constitution and the Declaration of Independence. You can imagine the Bill of Rights, but the Constitution. And the Constitution begins with, we the people of the United States of America, in order to create a more perfect union. And so I say, okay, stop. Because right there, what you're seeing is somebody saying a more perfect union. So there is a presumption that a union exists that wants to be perfected. Where did that union begin? And what is the basis of that union? And of course, I argue that it goes back to the Declaration of Independence in that those first lines where it says, we, now what is the we, how is that we brought together? Hold these truths to be self-evident. And what are they? The foundations are Judeo-Christians, that all men are created equal. That's an absurd notion in Islam. That they are endowed by their creator with certain inalienable rights. That's an absurd notion in Islamic theology. God is not your father, you have no rights. You are told to obey. That is Islamic theology, it's submission. And so my understanding is anytime you try to mix Sharia law with Western law, you are in danger because the presumptions of the very basis of an individual's dignity do not exist in Islamic theology.
All right, Dean Simons, can we get you up on stage to join, please? While he's coming up, I'll say this. I do spend a lot of time in England. I am, people who know me know that I tend to live in ruts. I eat at the same restaurants and order the exact same food and can do it every day and never be upset at all. I just spent 3 months in trial earlier this year, and every night for 3 months I had my mom's turkey meatballs. I was very happy, and she kept saying, let me make you something else. Why? I like it. When my wife and I first got married, Becky said, what do you want for dinner tonight? And after the third night of the same thing, she said, you live in a rut. And I said, you'll be very glad to know that, because I want to come home every night to the same wife at the same house. You know, it's got its pluses and its minuses. So I'm a rut guy. I have my favorite restaurants in London. One of them is Maz Goof's on Knightsbridge. And it is an Iraqi restaurant. If you go there during Ramadan, it's marvelous if you get there before the sun goes down, because no one is there eating. They're fasting. You have the restaurant to yourself. If you go during Ramadan after the sun goes down until 2 in the morning, you can't get a table. If you go there when it's not Ramadan and you get a table, or I get a table, I will frequently be surrounded with women who have the look of eyes only and everything else covered. And it's really fascinating for me because I want to watch to see how they eat. But I'm afraid culturally, if they realize that I'm going to see their mouth when they serve the food up there, I might get killed by their husbands because I don't know the law. So I'm sitting there trying to look without looking because I want to see, do they have like a zipper? Do they, what do they do, right? And I've got a favorite waiter at my favorite restaurant where I order the same thing every time. And his name is Roger, and he knows me, and he is from Iraq. And depending on who's in the restaurant, depends on whether or not he shakes my hand. because he doesn't want to offend me, and it's a very interesting thing, and if no one's around, it's Ramadan, and nobody is in there, he's, Mark, how's Texas? But if it's Ramadan, or not Ramadan, and people are in there, it's, hello, Mark, how are you? Can I get you a table? You know, and his hands are like this. It's just a fascinating deal. So here's the question. And I want the legal end of this to come into play. So in America, we are a pluralistic society. We say you have a freedom of religion. You can choose what you want to be and what you want to believe and how you want to practice. Should we in America fear a presence in our country of people who want to live under Sharia law? And if we should fear it, tell us why. And if we should not fear it, tell us why. And I want you law gurus, whichever one wants to start in.
thank you, Mark, and thank you for having us down here. And I should have known that I'd be risking being drafted to be up on this panel with experts. What Mark didn't say is I'm dean of the law school, but I'm a criminal law guy, not a law and religion guy. And I certainly don't know too much about Sharia law. But I'm going to answer first because Mark Movsesian knows more about the content of Sharia law and the way in which, in implementation, it may be fundamentally inconsistent, perhaps, with American values. But I think you hit the nail on the head. We're a pluralistic society and value that pluralism. And Sharia law can sound scary to us because we have these images of the way it's practiced in other parts of the world as being oppressive. And perhaps being connected to jihadism and some of these other things. And in America, we should follow American law. But if you think about our society, there are so many places in which, by agreement, people are operating under different legal systems. And as you were talking before, I was sitting there thinking, well, you know, I actually live in a world in which we operate by agreement under St. John's law. Within the university, there's an entire legal system of rules that we have made up, having to do with academic dishonesty and plagiarism and sexual harassment and unprofessional behavior and other kinds of things. And we enforce those rules and we impose punishments. Now, not corporal punishments, but fines and suspensions, and we change grades. And that's just one example of agreed upon networks of what are essentially legal regimes that people operate under all the time. Canon law in the Catholic Church is another example of that. So I think in the abstract, the American legal answer would be if a community, in this case a religious community, wants to organize their affairs and by agreement among themselves regulate their behavior, that should be fine, unless and until it becomes either involuntary, not by agreement, or in fundamental conflict with bigger legal principles that are rooted in American culture. For example, you know, if Sharia law results in something that we would say is cruel and unusual punishment, well, can't be done even if it's by agreement and people are consenting. But buried in your question is a political question. That's not just a legal question. And that gets to much broader issues of what is essentially now a global cultural and military conflict in some respects between the United States and the Western world and Islam. And I think it will be impossible to separate the questions of the application of Sharia law within Muslim communities in the US from the broader political questions about how comfortable we are more generally with Islam. And I think we're far down a road that's going to take us a long time to get through where we're not going to be comfortable as a political matter.
All right, in that regard, so many of you know because a number of you come to the class that I teach at Champion Forest Baptist Church, I get a lot of people who come up and visit with me after class. And I had a lady who came up and said, I have a real burden on my heart, Mark. Would you pray with me that the Supreme Court would change its rulings so that we can have mandatory prayer in public schools? And I looked at her, and I think I stunned her when I said, I cannot join in that prayer. And she said, why not? Don't you believe in prayer in schools? And I said, I'm all for everybody praying all the time, everywhere they are, but not mandatory prayer in public schools, because I happen to know that there are pockets of America, for example, in Salt Lake City, Utah, where 90% of the population is Mormon. And if they have a mandatory prayer in a public school, it will be a Mormon prayer that runs very counter to my theology. I would add, if there was an entire Sharia community that was predominantly Sharia, and they said at the public school where we have a Sharia teacher and we have a 75% Sharia populace, the prayer would be very different. And if they said we will have mandatory public prayer, it will be a Sharia prayer to Allah, or Muslim prayer, excuse me, to Allah, then, you know, I can't go there. That's crossing a line that I think is an important legal line. And I think in a way, it's what you're saying, that you can enforce Sharia law by agreement within certain paradigms or bubbles, but if it goes to a level where it's trumped by a greater principle, time out. Not here, not now. Is that what you're saying?
And interestingly, the exact hypothetical you just raised is something we have some experience with in New York, not involving Muslim communities, but involving Hasidic Jewish communities. And the ultra-Orthodox Jewish communities are not only insular, but because of the need to be able to walk to where they worship, end up very geographically concentrated. And there have been some instances where the community has become so concentrated that all of a sudden the school board changes to be majority Hasidic Jews. And now it's not just a matter of them applying Jewish law within their community, but it's having the actual political power in the community and then being able to impose not Jewish law, but at least their political goals on what becomes a non-Jewish minority in the community. There is law on that, and it's something we've wrestled with in New York City and in lower upper New York State for some time.
Interesting. Mark, talk to us about this issue. What are the concerns in America? What are the safeguards in America? How do you see this unfolding, perhaps, in the future? And then I've got my stinging legal discussion that we're going to get all four of you in on and see how it works. So we're going to change gears after you do this.
Okay, so just thank you. So just quickly, the answer I would give to your question, do we have to worry about Sharia law in America, is the lawyer's answer, which is it depends, right? It depends. That's always the lawyer's answer. Why does it depend? Well, first, quick background about Britain. So you asked a little while ago, is Sharia law being enforced in Britain? And yes. Yes, it is. I think the last estimate I have is that there are something like 85 Sharia tribunals in England and Wales. And these are tribunals. They are private. They're not state. They're more or less like private arbitration panels in which if you're a Muslim and you're in a dispute with another Muslim, a contract dispute, a commercial dispute, or a family law dispute, you can go to the tribunal, the imam will listen to you and will give you the rule that fiqh gives you. Fiqh, by the way, just so it gives a little pedantics, Sharia is the source of Islamic law. Islamic law is fiqh, right? It's sort of like the Torah and halacha in Judaism, right? So Sharia is the source of law, but the actual rules are called fiqh. It means knowledge.
Can you spell it, please?
F-I-Q-H would be the English transliteration, right? So you can go and get it, and this is going on all the time. Is it a big problem? I would say, well, if you're limiting it to things like commercial law, probably not, because that strikes me as a kind of private commercial arbitration. If you and I have a contract, we can agree to arbitrate outside the courts and settle it according to our own private rule of law. The dangerous thing that might happen would be if you have oppression going on in these tribunals, for example, in family law matters. And by the way, we shouldn't assume that's happening, but maybe it happens sometimes that people are being treated by our lights unfairly, like women are being automatically given one half of the estate and not whatever they're left in the estate. I'm sorry, they're given one half of what they're left in the will or something like this. In which case, then the state has to step in because no legal system can accept having contrary, equally valid legal systems within its territory. There has to be at least one answer somewhere. And that's what we have. So for example, if you are in a commercial arbitration and the arbitrator rules in a way that violates the public policy of the US, like says, yes, as a result of breach of contract, you are now the slave of the other party, right? Well, you're chuckling because of course, then you go to court and the court says, we're not enforcing this ruling. Sorry, that's against the public policy of the United States. If he says you have to pay $50,000 in damages, then the court says, okay, fine, right? So I think as long as we have in America the principle that public policy will prevail in a case in which these fiqh tribunals do something opposed to American fundamental policy, then we're okay. The danger would be, and this is the last thing I'll say, you might not find out about it. You might not find out about it, right? So somebody might lose in one of these fiqh tribunals and the result would be something we would think is terrible under our value system and the courts would never hear about it because there will be such community pressure that this person will never go to the secular courts, will never go to America, because you know, that's the outside world, we don't want to be a part of that, and that's a danger. So as I say, it depends.
All right, so here's, we're shifting gears for a moment, and I'm really intrigued about this. There's a lawyer at my law firm. I won't use his name, but he is a Democrat to the marrow of his bones. I don't think he even says the word Republican, much less votes for one, without spitting in the process, okay? What you would call from the old times a yellow dog Democrat, which for the younger people out there means he would vote for a yellow dog if that yellow dog were a Democrat before he would vote for a Republican, all right? Yeah, no, actually, this fella's in our Houston office, okay? And is a Baptist, all right? So in the last election, I said to him, so when are you going to go cast your ballot for Obama? And he looked at me and he says, I'm not going to vote for Obama. I said, what? He says, I'm not going to vote for Obama. I said, what happened to you? And he said, I cannot vote for him. At some point, my principles of the Constitution of the United States trump even my politics. And I said, and flesh this out a little bit for me. And he said something that had happened that I think most Americans, and I'll go a step further and say most conservative Republicans, probably are not upset over, yet perhaps should be. Here is what so upset my friend that caused him for the first time in his life not to vote for a Democrat for national office. There was an American citizen living in Kuwait who was arguably involved or seems to have been involved, if we're to accept the media reports and the government information, with doing computer work for Al-Qaeda. And our president ordered a drone to go strike and kill this man. Now, the U.S. Constitution and constitutional law is pretty clear that all men are presumed innocent until proven guilty. In a court of law, by a jury of their peers, in fact, in the Declaration of Independence, one of the reasons we declared independence from King George was the fact that he was depriving us of a right to a jury trial by our peers. We have amendments, the Bill of Rights, that secure that right to a jury trial. And this is a strong presumption that we are innocent until proven guilty. And that's whether we're on American soil or not, if we're a U.S. citizen. And the president decides, based upon his information, this man is an enemy of the state, and sends a drone, doesn't send Americans in to capture him, to bring him back, to put him to trial, sends a drone, kills him. And my lawyer said, I'll never vote for that man again. He's destroyed the Constitution in a way that should make every American tremble. Now, we've got a legal panel up here. I want to talk to them about it. And I brought it up over lunch and I warned them. And they both said, we're not constitutional lawyers. I said, no, that cop-out doesn't work. You still know more about it than everybody else. Mark worked, before he went to work as a law professor, he was working for the justice system, the NDC, the Office of Legal Counsel for the White House. They're the ones who prepare the legal memos that justify or chart whether or not this type of stuff can be done. Before he became dean of the law school, Dean Simons, Mike Simons, was a prosecutor for the U.S. government. And these guys know this stuff. It's part of the warp and woof of what they do. So I'm going to be really nasty here, and I'm going to be very blunt. And I'm going to ask them the hard legal questions, and then you two are my focus group as non-lawyers who are going to say, hey, that's a fine thing to do. We're keeping the U.S. of A. safe. So I've told these guys on the law side, they can take either side they want. I'll be the advocate of the other side, and I'll argue against them. I can argue both sides of the coin. It is a very narrow coin. There are two sides to this coin. So who's going to start, and what argument do you want to make? And then I'll start pushing buttons.
I'll go first. And Mark answered the last question with the lawyer's response, it depends. I'll answer this question with the academic's response, which is, that's a very difficult question. and there really are good arguments on both sides. Actually, it's three different questions. It's a legal question, a political question, and then a diplomatic or international law question. The end of my answer is, of those three, the legal answer is the least important. The legal question is actually pretty straightforward. The way Mark phrased the question, you know, our Constitution guarantees presumption of innocence. We don't. Some states we don't even execute people, but even in Texas we don't execute people without a trial and a jury. And we just sent an unmanned drone over there to blow this guy up, and he happened to be a U.S. citizen. When you phrase it that way, it sounds so obviously unconstitutional. Think about dropping the atomic bomb on Hiroshima and the devastation that inflicted. Was that obviously unconstitutional? Well, frankly, no. You might think it, or might not think it was a great injustice, but why was it not unconstitutional? Well, there was a declaration of war by Congress, and the president, in his capacity as commander-in-chief, which is laid out in the Constitution, was waging war. And it's pretty clear that that's allowed under the Constitution, or at least in our constitutional structure, the judicial branch is not going to step in and start saying to the president, you can or you can't do this in the context of fighting a war. With regard to this particular question, can we assassinate, drones or not, assassinate American citizens overseas? The legal answer is, well, there was an act by Congress, the authorization for the use of military force in the wake of 9/11 against al-Qaeda in the context of the war on terror. And there's a finding by the Office of Legal Counsel, the office that Mark used to work in under a different president, that so long as certain conditions are met, and that is capture is not feasible, the target is part of a dangerous enemy group, and the danger from that enemy group is imminent and certain, then an assassination is authorized. That's the legal justification. Now, you could argue about whether the 2001 Act of Congress should still extend this far beyond Afghanistan. What is al-Qaeda? How do you define it? And then you can argue about the interpretation the Justice Department has put on it, that within the commander-in-chief power, so long as these conditions are met, you're within the congressional authorization. And then you can, of course, challenge the facts. In this particular case, was capture infeasible? Was al-Awlaki, was the al-Qaeda target's name, part of a dangerous enemy group? And was the danger imminent? the reason I say that the legal question is not nearly as important as the political question is, in some ways, we're not going to get a legal answer to that question. There's been litigation about this. The litigation is not targets claiming my rights have been violated because you tried to blow me up. It's the ACLU trying to get copies of the memos. That's a political fight. And what the ACLU there is doing is not trying to change the law, but try to change American opinion about what the administration is doing with these drones. And my prediction, and I'm not a political prognosticator, is that American opinion is going to change, but slowly, and not when we feel imminently threatened by Al-Qaeda or other terrorist groups. Now, that's not a legal answer. That's not rooted in the Constitution. That's just rooted in raw politics. And interestingly, your colleague's reaction was a political one, right? He didn't bring a lawsuit. He decided not to vote for Obama because he was offended by the politics. And there are many aspects of constitutional law, particularly those like this one, where there are not obvious litigants who can bring a claim and have it assert that my claim should be enforced, where ultimately the questions are really political. And the judicial branch is probably not going to step in and tell the executive branch what they can or cannot do in the context of essentially waging a war. And the only way it's going to change is the polity, the people, voting in different policies. The third piece, and this gets more back to drones, I said it's a diplomatic or international law question. And this is a very interesting one regarding drone technology. Drones are cheap and increasingly very effective. And one of the issues the United States is going to have to confront is, what do we do in the realm of international law, which again is really diplomacy and politics, as drones and the ability to launch unarmed attacks increases, right? Drones are obviously cheaper and easier to get than nuclear weapons or cruise missiles or even a fighter jet. And if Amazon is going to be delivering books via drones, all kinds of regimes can be using drones for all kinds of purposes, nefarious purposes, in part because they're so effective. So I actually predict that our official government position on the use of this kind of technology, maybe not in the next couple of years, but within 10 years, will be to try to characterize this kind of thing as something more akin to chemical weapons that are dangerous precisely because they're readily available and so effective.
All right, Mark?
I'm not sure really what I can add to that. I think that's... So, except I will just say this, you know, I mean, to be an American citizen has to mean something, and we're in a chapel, and I'm reminded, of course, of the famous story in Acts of St. Paul, who's going to get beat up by the Romans, and he says, is it lawful to beat a Roman citizen? And they go, whoa, wait a minute, you didn't tell us you're a Roman citizen, and the governor gets really mad and says, you know, what are you doing, you know? And they send him off to Caesar, right? So, you know, it's got to mean something, and the idea that we can just pick off American citizens at random around the world because of a finding which will be kept secret, won't be revealed to us what the basis is. Now, al-Awlaki, I think we all know he was in al-Qaeda. That was not a surprise, right? But we're not going to see the evidence for this, correctly so, because they can't share sources and methods. Even assuming everything that Dean Simon says is let's assume all the boxes are checked, right? Okay, American citizen, which means the Constitution applies to him, but we have an authorization of use of military force, and even though the Constitution applies to him in an exigent circumstance where he imminently threatens the United States and capture is not possible, we can get him, and we get him, right? All of that is going to depend on how much you trust the president when he says, I have my reasons to think this guy is bad.
Yeah, this is, focus groups coming up. Does and I recognize we are in Texas, which votes overwhelmingly, generally, for the Republican side of things. George Bush was still viewed as a marvelous president by most people in Texas. But it's got to stir up something in you that we're trusting a government that said, we have absolute proof Saddam Hussein is manufacturing weapons of mass destruction. When we get over there and find out that all of the proof we thought we had was wrong. Now, he may have had some that he hid, but we've never been able to find any evidence of it. And certainly, I think everyone now agrees that the pictures of what we thought were weapons of mass destruction were not weapons of mass destruction. So you've got a president in Bush that we wanted to trust, where his intel seems to have been wrong. We've got a president in Obama that many don't want to trust, and yet we're going to trust that his intel was right. I mean, at what point should we ever be concerned as citizens that we have a president who has the authority to tell someone in Virginia to sit there with a joystick and guide something over in Kuwait and push a button and kill a citizen because of information we'll never be privy to? Is there a concern, or is this a good thing? Focus group. Take it away. Go. He didn't even get last rites, Father.
There is no such thing as last rites.
All right.
I mean, if you ever want to talk about that in Catholic theology, there are no last rites.
Okay, he didn't get medium rites. He sure didn't get legal rites, but that's spelled R-I-G-H-T.
I am not a lawyer, and I cannot answer on constitutional basis or any kind of legal basis. I would struggle with that as a moral decision. I have to speak, I've got to be careful here because I cannot speak as a representative of the Catholic Church. The Catholic Church would have if you take it to the just war theory, you know, the whole just war principles, but this is more of I was thinking about it in terms of a police action. If a police department saw that there was a person in a home preparing some kind of aiding at some kind of a bomb, do they have...
This is marvelous, because this is where I'm coming back on Simons in a minute. Well, I'm going to say, so if they'd known about Timothy McVeigh beforehand, could the president on his own have gone, kill him with a drone?
That would be interesting. You know, again, why I do not speak as a Catholic, from the Catholic perspective, okay? I think you could come down on either side of the coin. In Catholic tradition, there are much more pacifists than there are hawks. I am a hawk. Because I am hawk in the Catholic tradition, I constantly struggle because I sincerely want to be a disciple of Jesus Christ. And yet, I understand the argument for defense, not only self-defense, but the defense of another. And I have a right to give my own life as Jesus did, but I don't have the right to give the life of another as a martyr. And so if I know that I can stop the murder of another as a martyr, is that, can I make a decision that is 100% without doubt, as you mentioned with Obama and Bush? I think that they made prudential decisions. And I think when a prudential decision is made, it's not an absolute decision about right or wrong. It's made what is reasonable and prudent. At any given time, trying to save as much human life as humanly possible. And so, given all of that, I would have pushed the button.
All right, Jim?
I don't have an answer, I have a question. Maybe t-
to be asked of our lawyers if, and I'm not sure what the current laws are with respect to treason and going over to the enemy, and do you retain your rights once you've joined an army that is declared you, the U.S., as its great Satan that you want to destroy? I don't know if that changes the picture. I don't know what the law is, but I would certainly be very supportive of a law. I join my hawkish friend here and say perhaps we need to clarify the law that if an American citizen joins a terrorist organization that is avowedly aimed at our destruction, that they lose the rights of a citizen.
Okay, does it bother you, though, to think that, first of all, what if they joined that organization, not in the sense of destroying America by killing people a la 911?
Allah or Allah? Allah.
Bad pun. But rather, they joined it in the sense of destroying America by trying to get us off being such a hedonistic, self-centered, pornographic, profiting, gambling nation of sin.
David Carr.
Yes. And making us more of a holy, righteous nation of saints. Now, if that's their idea of destroying America, do we have a right to blow them up without trying them first?
You're looking at me.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, I would argue that as a Christian, like the Apostle Paul says to his audience, since we're talking about him in Caesarea, he says, I wish everybody to be here like I am, except for these chains. I don't think anybody should have to be constrained by any other group, ideological or political, to accept our way or the highway, or as we might say to our Jewish friends, our way is Yah's way. So I think they're trying to compel by force and intimidation a conversion, and I would agree with many Muslims.
So we just blow them up.
No. But I would agree that many Muslims, they see us as decadent, and we've been importing our immoral culture through Hollywood all over the world, and they've seen this, and for them it's shocking. But the answer to that I think should be the approach of moral persuasion, not force, terror, and militarization. I would say that would be the way to go, but that's not the route they've chosen.
Okay, so let's put it into some words that let's change the perspective a little bit. And please understand, one of the joys of being a lawyer is the ability to argue both sides of a coin. And I'm only arguing this not because I believe it necessarily, but because they're arguing the other side, and I got to put it to test. So, abortion clinics are seen as killing human lives. And as such, there are people who are willing to sacrifice their own life and their own liberty to try and save the lives of the millions of babies that are aborted each year in America. Now, who is the terrorist in that situation? And does the President of the United States have the ability to launch a drone and to take out one side or the other, depending upon whom the President, be that he or she, decides is the true terrorist? Oh, darn. He's going to tell me that there's no
declaration. I edited a book on abortion with a number of different contributions to it. I think your library has a copy, so.
All right. Dean Simons, come on.
Well, now that our neutral moderator has admitted that he's actually advocating for one side,
I'll turn the question around with a hypothetical. And this has nothing to do with abortion, but imagine a terrorist commandeers an airplane full of people and is going to crash it into a heavily populated area. Do we blow him up if we have that capacity? There's a fighter jet in the area or a drone that can do it, and by the way, kill all the innocent people on the plane. Or do we say, no, we have to have a trial first. We need an arrest warrant, we need a jury, we need to go through our process. And so we can't take pre-legal defensive action. And pretty clearly the legal answer in the United States is no, you don't have to wait. This is just straightforward self-defense law. It's not war on terror law, it's not drone law, it's straightforward self-defense law. If someone's about to do something bad, like blow up an abortion clinic, or like kill a baby in a context in which the legal regime is going to say that's illegal, and the only way to stop them is with lethal force, it's authorized. Police are authorized to do it. Non-police are authorized to do it. In most states, under most legal concepts, it's just straightforward self-defense. And in some ways, if you think about the way the Obama administration is trying to justify the use of drones against foreign terrorists, is in that kind of straightforward self-defense way. It's almost the same standard. Now, if you think about the question that Jim raised, should we be able to do that in the United States with someone who is treasonous? I would answer, we already can in standard law enforcement context. Terrorist has a bomb and is, you know, driving through an uninhabited area and is about to get to the inhabited area where he's gonna blow up the bomb. So long as the boxes are checked, meaning the threat is imminent, we reasonably believe the threat is imminent, and the only way to neutralize that threat is to use deadly force, then you can do it. And most of us, I think, would have very little issue with that. The bigger question becomes that then factual issue, is the threat imminent? And do we trust the person who's making that decision? And I think I could easily imagine the Office of Legal Counsel coming up with memos that would tell the president he's authorized to use drone strikes in the United States against people who are at imminent danger of committing terrorist acts. And I think the population would not stand for it. I think if the administration adopted that policy, the political winds would shift very quickly on the use of the drones, and it wouldn't work for political reasons. But basic self-defense law, which is an agreed upon principle in our legal system, would in many cases allow it.
Okay, but in self-defense law,
you notice how I got him off constitutional law and into criminal law, which is where...
Yeah, now I'm way out of my league, although I was out of my league to start with. In self-defense law, like you're talking about, the police officer or whomever does that act is held to account for proving those elements, has to prove that to some degree, if not held into account, I mean, if not having to prove, at least held into account, not accepting what's going to happen in Missouri and all the rest of that mess. You know, you taught my daughter's criminal law class and had my daughter chase you around the room because you were teaching the theory of retreat and when you can use reasonable force, and policemen can't just shoot someone who's running away because of that imminent danger issue. Now, my question is, who's going to hold the president to account when the president does this, when Professor Movsesian can sit there and pull up the memo from the Office of Legal Counsel to read the justification and find it's all blacked out because we're not allowed to know? Who holds who to account?
Well, the way this happens when police kill in self-defense or homeowners kill in self-defense, there was a recent trial, I think it was in Chicago, where a homeowner shot and killed a lost motorist who came to his house for directions. the homeowner actually doesn't have to prove anything. The prosecuting authority has to prove the charges. Murder, intentional killing. The defendant says self-defense, and then in most states, I don't know what the law is in Texas, but I bet it's the same as in New York, the prosecution actually has to disprove the self-defense. The prosecution has to prove beyond a reasonable doubt that the defendant either did not believe it was necessary to use deadly force or that the belief was unreasonable. So the kind of flip answer to your question is if President Obama decided that Mark Lanier was a dangerous terrorist and dropped a bomb here, are we in Harris County?
We are in Harris County, but this is bomb-proof.
So the charge then would not be murder, but attempted murder. The district attorney of Harris County could indict him. Or indict the general that ordered it, or the lieutenant that pressed the button. And then our legal system would deal with it. And in the context in which it wasn't Mark Lanier, but someone about whom there was good evidence that they were an Al-Qaeda terrorist, imminently about to engage in terrorist activity.
Who's in Kuwait at the time, so you don't have a prosecutor with jurisdiction. Yemen.
There isn't a district attorney in the country that's going to go indict the president for that. So the legal structures are in place to deal with it. And at the end of the day, I keep saying this, it comes back to a political question. And I think, and this is not to be flip, you're actually asking a political question, not a legal question. And in essence, what you're suggesting is that President Obama has the wrong policy, not because it somehow violates a segment of the United States Code or a provision of the Constitution, but because it's inconsistent with American values. And the values reflected in all men are created equal, the values reflected in our due process clause, the values reflected in our legal system, and therefore he should change his policy or we should change who the president is.
Or perhaps the due process was violated because those three elements aren't really checked off. If the three elements aren't checked, I mean, the guy's driving down the road. Right. He's a computer man. What was the imminent danger? This is not a bomb that's about to explode on American soil.
Now, let me be clear. Computer man doesn't mean he's repairing computers. Computer man means he's posting videos on YouTube calling for jihad, imminent jihad. And you've identified a central problem here in that there is no one who is positioned to bring the legal challenge that'll force the government to lay out their evidence. And if that challenge is brought, the government will invoke national security law and secrecy laws and say, yeah, you just have to trust us. And that's different than what's gonna happen in Ferguson, right? The police officer in Ferguson either is or isn't gonna get indicted. Even if he is indicted, he's gonna be sued and there's gonna be a lawsuit and the facts will come out. And one of the dangers in this national security area is, as Mark said, the facts don't come out.
All right, last thing, and then we will break for before this evening and give these gentlemen a chance to rest, give Mark particularly a chance to get his thoughts together. Mark, can you give us a one-minute synopsis, a tease, if you will, about what you're going to be presenting tonight?
We're giving away substantial cash bounties at the door. So tonight's talk is going to be about religious freedom for Mideast Christians yesterday and today. I'm going to do three things. First, I'm going to introduce Mideast Christianity, because I think many American Christians don't know too much about the churches of the Middle East. Second, I will talk about ISIS, and I will show how what ISIS is doing is not without precedent in Islamic history, and how, in fact, it is part of a kind of classical Islamic treatment of Christians. And then third, I will talk about the silence of the West and give you my thoughts about why the West is comparatively quiet about what is happening to Christians in the Middle East, and then suggest some things that might be done.
And there will be Q&A afterwards. You'll get to write down your questions. As usual, we'll get to pop them to him. There'll be a delightful reception. At any rate, would you join me in thanking all of these gentlemen for what they've said?